been producing in my own way since 1991, and I'd say professionally since about 94. Back then, there weren't any options as far as laptops and much in the way of that, except for academic things that weren't available to anyone. For myself, a synth needs to, it's just the user interface. It's all that cliche stuff of, you know, I just want to go and quickly do it. But that still is kind of like a theme that reigns true. It's like if you're playing sports, you know, the gear has to fit your personal vibe. If I want to create a sound, I want to be able to use the tool without having to think about how it works. And I also have to learn it and just kind of stick with it. But those are the tools that kind of stand the test of time for me. When I'm choosing my instruments, I'm going back to having a lot of fun with samples and trying to build my own little libraries. And the problem now with libraries is you get very lost very quickly. There's thousands of sounds on everyone's hard drive. So I'm trying to manage that, and I'm trying to go back to my favorites. A lot of new DSP software options are getting quite good. I think myself and everybody else that I sort of look up to, when laptops became a thing, we all thought, oh, this is great. We sold all our synths, and then we sort of realized that, like, this isn't quite the same. So then we all bought some synths again, and now I think things are more interesting than ever, and you can get really affordable, amazing tools. I was able to buy some fun toys, and I try to keep it organized. For instance, I just got a hold of Oberheim SEM again, which just same as like a SH-101 or 202, it's just always going to sound good for the job that it does. For me, that's a lot of bass lines and that sort of thing. But I just know that's going to sit in its right place, the same way a 909 kick sits in the right place for house and techno music, you know. When it comes to polys, which are the Dave Smith OB6 and the Deckard's Dream, both have a unique character set in their own way. And that's what makes them interesting. They're quite different from each other. So that's why I'll go poly-wise, a little bit of Eurorack. I find, even with the other stuff, I had to make myself a small case because otherwise I'm not going to use anything. So I sort of like to bring stuff in front of me and use it and then put it away and not always have the same setup. I like to change the setup quite frequently just to get myself excited. I'm not a Eurorack master patcher at all. I usually do quite simple things with it, but just to have even like the pingable envelope generator as a modulation source that I can clock, it just becomes so easy to patch things. I've got the Schwaemann S1, which is also working together with that, and it's just so great to have these very easy sources. I think as great as the software side is, my goal with hardware is to have stuff that's even easier to use. So that would be an example of something easier for me than dragging a cable on the screen from one place to the other. To know that I can, while it's running, get all these different modulation shapes quite easily and patch them in. I try to be as choosy as I can. Obviously, there's always gear lust, but I try to keep it so everything has a specific purpose and something I can go to and something that I've maybe used for years that I know how it's gonna behave and do the job. For me, the most powerful thing, better than opening any EQ or compressor or anything, is just to put the sound in the right place. And I find that really helps. There's many times when I started a mix from scratch and it's just not sounding right. And I take all the plugins off and I just make one gain change and I turn it up and it's like, that already sounds 10 times better. So yeah, for me, levels and the sound to begin with. If the sound doesn't have the harmonic content that I need, sure, I can add some synthetic processes to it to add some upper octave harmonics or some bass synthesis. But if it's not there in the beginning, the best thing for me is just to realize the sound's not working, get a new sound, and sometimes that's really hard to do. I work in a variety of different ways. Sometimes I work with a DAW, sometimes I work without a DAW. I actually, at the moment, use four different DAWs. I enjoy, some of the most popular ones. Of course, there's Logic, there's Ableton. I really like what Bitwig's doing. And I also use a tracker called Renoise. And the tracker is very interesting to me because it takes the visual out of the picture. So sometimes I've released quite a few things where I think if I had a visual of a timeline, I wouldn't have done it, or I wouldn't have stopped. And just to take my visual out of the picture and just use my ears, I really write a bit different. And the same is true when I use maybe an MPC or some older Roland stuff or Electron boxes. Especially with the Electron stuff, you're limited to a number of tracks, which my old school brain gets a good comfort in, for better or worse. And sometimes, obviously, if I'm doing a remix and I get 48 stems or 60 stems, I need to have that visual representation, otherwise there's just no way to do it. So it just depends on the job, but it's nice to not have to look at something when you're creative and just let the imagination run. I'm not a fan of things being too perfect. I mean, all of the classics that I can think of, there's something very unique about them. Some people who've made amazing classics, I've gotten to be really good friends with them, and then when you discover how they made it, it's just like, well, you're not supposed to be able to do that. But I think that's what makes it classic. I think the first time producers were using real drum sounds instead of stock drum machine sounds, you know, Marley Marl comes to mind, who's a big idol of mine. And this stuff wouldn't exist without this sort of misuse. So I think the one thing I always sort of try to practice is vibe. Obviously, if the mix is way off, that's a problem. But if there's little problems and things are sitting in the right place, I think vibe is much more important than perfection. And then if in the end there's not so much to have to change, then I think a second pair of ears, a good mastering engineer, can just, you know, do that little bit of stuff. And I think perfection actually is boring. There's so much polished stuff out these days. And I don't care for it so much.